It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Bechand, Gerard Bechand. His next speaker, he's from Institute Fourier, Université de Grenoble, France. And he will deliver a series of lectures on compactness and finiteness result for Gromov hyperbolic spaces. So I request Professor Bechand to please continue.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Okay, I'm very happy to be back in India. First time in Varanasi, beautiful city. And so I wish to thank everybody, in particular Simpa, for giving us this opportunity. It's a very nice institution. The local organizers, Mankeshwar, and the volunteers. And my friend Atanas, who was the first writing to me about this. Okay, so we Gilles Courtois and myself, we decided to change a little bit the program, well, not a little bit, completely, actually. And we decided to talk about a subject which is the central subject in a recent paper of ours. So we want to describe the main ideas and some of the results. I said recent papers, although we started it 19 years ago, but it's almost finished. And I said 19, not 90. Okay. So this brings me to the next point. So you said that mathematics is a question of friendship, so I want to present my collaborators who are friends also. So we will be discussing a joint work between myself, Gilles Courtois, so who is in the room, Sylvain Gallo, who was mentioned this morning because she somehow used the book Gallo Hulin Lafontaine, and Andrea Sambuzetti. So Gilles is in Paris, Sylvain is affiliated to Institut Fourier, and Andrea is in Rome. And, Norbert, our toy is this, a metric space. So we want to study metric spaces. So this, of course, includes Finsler spaces. So except that we are working with symmetric metrics. It's not that we don't like a non-symmetric metric, it's just that we don't know how to work with it. And maybe we could extend this to these cases. But at the moment, we don't know. And so examples of metric spaces have been presented, a beautiful example by Atanas, and that will come in the story a little bit later. So what do we want to do with this? So one of the goals, which explains the title, is to look at the space of metric spaces, of course, with extra assumptions. That we will describe more precisely during the lectures. So altogether we have 10 hours, so that's perfect. And this space can be endowed with a distance function, which I call DGH. So for those who are familiar, this G is for Gromov and the H is for Hausdorff. And so we can turn this space of metric spaces with extra assumptions, which we will describe, into a metric space. And so ultimately, the goal is to show that with the correct assumptions, this space is compact. So be careful, it's not true in general. We have to precise the assumption that we need to get this kind of result. So compactness is interesting for various reasons. So this explains one of the words that appear in the title. And the second one is finiteness. And we'll try to show that in some instances, there are finitely many topology in a sense that we will make more precise later. OK. So it's very simple. We just have a distance function at n, and so we can only write the triangle inequality, sometimes quadrangle inequality. We can draw balls and cover big balls by small balls. That's the only thing we can do. I'm cheating a little bit. We will need a little bit of algebraic topology, but we will recall the facts that we will need when it is needed. All right. So let me start by describing some of the assumptions that are mentioned here. Oh, I didn't make precise the fact that. So we'll describe theorems, but we'll also do proof. And
extra assumptions will prevent this from belonging to itself.
To belonging to what?
To itself.
Yes, of course. Okay, so let's start by some assumptions. So we will restrict our attention to some special kind of metric spaces. So first of all, this is a topological space. This is a distance. And the topology is induced by the distance, so we are in a very safe situation. And we'll assume that the space is proper. X is proper, which means that closed balls are compact. So it's not a random assumption, and for example, it has a consequence that we won't be able to consider infinite dimensional objects. So if you think to norm spaces, when you ask the closed ball, the balls to be compact, the closed ball to be compact, then it is necessary to have a finite dimensional space. And we don't know how to deal with infinite dimensional objects, but this is another story. So this is the first assumption. Okay, and then I want to talk about curves and geodesy. So what I didn't say that the space will take this space to be connected to avoid any useless difficulty. So curves. So let's take 2 points in the space and assume that there is a continuous curve, C, say from 0, 1. So this one is called X, the second one is called Y, such that C of 0 is X, C of 1 is Y. And C is continuous. So I want to be able to talk about length. So we do the standard thing. We subdivide the curve and so on. And this is xk. And we approximate, well, I should not say it this way. Let me, no, I'm sorry. That's OK. I'm like Norbert, a bit tight today. Okay, and you can compute the sum of the distances between xi and xi plus 1 from I going to from 0 to k minus 1. Right, so this is a number. You approximate by a finitely many numbers. And you look at the supremum of this for all subdivisions. It's not completely correct to write things like this, but let me do it anyway. Okay? And if this is finite, then we say that the curve is rectifiable. C is rectifiable. And this supremum we'll call the length of the curve C. Right? So we'll make this extra assumption now that the space is a so-called length space that is between any 2 point there is a rectifiable curve.
Could you provide the definition of
Let me not comment this, but as I said, this is a bit cheating, but and then we'll discuss details later. So X will be assumed to be a length space, which means that between any two points, X, Y in X, there is a rectifiable curve, at least one. And the distance between X and Y is the infinitum of the length of all rectifiable curves which join X and Y. So the distance is achieved by curve for which we can compute the length. And so if we have a space in which this is satisfied, then it will be called a length space, right? So we'll this is one of the strong assumptions that we are. No, well, later I will add another assumption, but apparently, no. Yeah, at this stage, no. Well, now I come to geodesics, and there we will need the infinitum to be achieved by some very nice curve. But the studying length space is a very active subject nowadays. Okay, so this is one first assumption. The second one is that there are geodesics, and we have seen many examples. So I'm sorry, I have to erase what I have just written. Right. Okay. So this we know. So what are geodesics in this context? A geodesic is a map from some interval in R into the space, which is an isometric embedding. Meaning that the distance between C of S and C of T is equal to T minus S, and this for every ST in R. So it differs a little bit from the Riemannian geometric case, where in Riemannian geometry, we define a geodesic as satisfying a differential equation, and it's not always minimizing on all its length. So, but for us here, geodesics always minimize the length on the whole interval. Right? And we'll assume X to be a geodesic space, which means that it is proper, a length space, and between any two points, there is at least one geodesic. So which achieves the length, distance between the points, so achieves the infinitum that I wrote before. There are plenty of examples of such spaces which are very wild. And during the lectures, we'll try to give as many examples as we can. Today, I'll give very elementary ones. Maybe tomorrow, more interesting examples. But okay, here is the right context. So let me give one example. But before I make one remark, so there are metric spaces without rectifiable curves. Without rectifiable curve. And they are very interesting. And they are, for example, appear naturally when you do geometry in negative curvature. The boundary at infinity that was mentioned by Atanas this morning is a naturally metric space, but usually there are no rectifiable curves. If they were, we would be happy and we would prove plenty of theorem, but sometimes we are stuck. So I'm not saying that this situation is not interesting, but in our context and for what we want to do, I mean, we need to have geodesic spaces. Okay, so let me give the easiest example. So people always forget have a tendency to forget the easiest example. I'm looking at my drawing actually because I want to be able. So I've been thinking to this drawing, actually. So, okay, so let me draw something and then I'll explain. Right. So the easiest example is a graph. So here I'm supposed to draw a graph. So here is a vertex V1, V0, V2, V3, V5, V6, V7, I don't need more. And I draw this graph not as a combinatorial object, but as a one-dimensional object. So the edges here are one-dimensional objects, and the distance I want to put in this graph is such that the edges are isometric to the interval, for example, 0, 1. Could do plenty of other things. So here is an interval which is isometric to 0, 1, here 2, and here 2, which makes the computation of distance between two points very easy. For example, the distance from this to this one is 2. Distance from this to this one is 3, and so on and so forth. Okay, so for example, if we take this point here, V0 and V3, well, on the picture, we can see two rectifiable curves going from V0 to V3. Well, there are plenty more, because you might go very far where there is a cycle which allows you to come back, or you might go and just come back like this. But at least on the picture, we see that these are the shortest path from V0 and V3, right? So these are the two geodesics going from V0 and V3. And this example emphasizes the fact that we are not asking the geodesic between two points to be unique, right? So this example is very important. It looks trivial, but it is very important. Okay, I'll come back on that. We'll come back on that several times during the lecture. Okay, so now I want to define some notion that was alluded to or mentioned by Athanase, which is the notion of hyperbolicity in the sense of Gromov. So the idea which is behind this stuff is usually in Riemannian geometry, for those who are familiar with this, if one has bounds on the curvature, for example, a lower bound on the sectional curvature, then you prove, well, or it has been proved, triangular comparison, Toponogov comparison theorem, for example. And so this is something we do in mathematics that Norbert has not mentioned in his overview, that sometimes you reverse the thing and you take the result of the theorem as a definition. So I'll give definition of curvatures. In fact, we will give two during the lectures. Using triangle comparison. So let me be more precise. So I will talk about a subject for which there are references, and I'm happy to mention these references. So for me, the most accessible one is a book by Cornhart, Delzon, and Papadopoulos. It's a lecture note. It is very accessible, and you reach very quickly the interesting information. Unfortunately, it's written in French. Unfortunately for you, but because for me it's okay. And so I'm trying to push Athanase to do some translation. But it's very accessible, and there is a more complete book so by Brightson and Effliger. Probably the title is something like Spaces of Non-Positive Curvature. Let me not write the title. And it's not a lecture note, it's Springer. It's something like Ergebnisse. So it's a very thick book, and there are plenty of interesting things inside. But since the book is thick, it's more difficult to find one precise argument. So if you are a beginner in this kind of subject, I would suggest to start with the Athanas lecture note, which maybe will be translated someday. Okay, so let me come to triangles. Okay, so what is a triangle in a metric space? Well, just 3 points. So 3 points in X. And I need edges. And so if we assume the space to be geodesic, between these 3 points, they are geodesics. There might be several, so I choose one. And here two, and here two. So given 3 points, there might be several triangles that you can draw, but it doesn't matter. What I'm going to say should be true for every triangle. Right? So here's the length, gamma, beta, and alpha. So these are numbers and length of the sides. We are in metric space, so we can do this. And to this, we can associate a Euclidean triangle, which I draw here, and call A bar, B bar, C bar, with the same length on the side. With this equal to this, so length gamma, this equal to this, length beta, and the third one equal to this one, length alpha. So this is always possible because of the triangle inequalities, and let me leave this as an exercise. So this triangle is called delta, this triangle is called delta bar. So exercise is show the existence of delta bar. It's a classical fact. If you have never done this exercise, I would suggest to do it. And the only thing I'm saying is that the length of the side are the same than on the original triangle. Okay, but now we are in a very nice situation where you can do elementary geometry. So you know that in a Euclidean triangle, this one is in R2 actually, with the Euclidean distance. In French, we never put the uppercase, but I should do it, right? So in a Euclidean triangle, there is an inscribed circle. It doesn't look like a circle, but it is, believe me. So the largest circle that you can put inside, and so it touches in 3 points, the boundary of the triangle, 1 point for each, in this situation, 1 point for each edge, right? So maybe this is annoying to have this on the picture, right? And it's also a classical fact that this length here is equal to this one, and the same on the other side. If you are not familiar with this, you should think to two-dimensional geometry. So what I'm going to do now is identify these two segments and get one segment at this length. So let me, to avoid problems, let me put this here and get here this length. So I'm going to call this A star. So these 2 points are identified. And I do the same here. I get here B star. So it would be two bars. These two are equal. And the same on the third side. And get here C star. Right? And so I get an object, geometric object, which is called a tripod, T. So I should call it T star. It's called a tripod. So it's a metric graph, but only with four vertices. So it's a metric tree. Well, except that the length is not, length of the edges is not one, but it's given by these, the length of this side, the length of this side, and the length of this one. Right? So because of these equalities in length, you can find a map, say f bar from the triangle to the tripod, which is an isometry on each side, f bar. So we change this isometrically to this, this isometrically to this, so that this side is sent isometrically to this broken segment, and the same for the others. We don't care about what's inside. For me, the triangle is just a boundary. And of course, we have the same thing here, because the length are the same. And it's a geodesic, so it parameterizes. So you can send this isometrically to this, and this side isometrically to this one. And so finally, we get a map from delta, the original triangle, to the tripod, so that it is isometric on each side, not globally, of course, because when you take 2 points here, the distance may be achieved inside, but at least on one side, right? On each side. Remember that we are taking geodesic here, right? So now if we fix a number delta, a real number, we'll say that the triangle capital delta is small delta thin if anytime you pick 2 points on the triangle, so for example, this one and another one here, y, such that, so this is not a good example, such that f, so let me call it f delta of x equal f delta of y. So 2 points which are sent on the same point over there, for example, x here and y here, so let's forget about this one, which are sent on the point here, x star, then one has the distance between x and y in this space is less than delta. Or in other words, this triangle is just a thickening of the tripod. It looks more like this and thickened by a quantity which is related to this delta. So it doesn't look like this, but it looks like this. And certainly it doesn't look like this. Right? And the space XD is said to be delta hyperbolic. So sometime we add in the sense of Gromov, because he's the one who had introduced this notion. If all triangles are delta thin. So if this is true for every triangle, right? So it's a very simple definition. And this is explained in the book I mentioned before. Okay, so before saying more about this delta hyperbolicity, let us think two examples. So there are essentially two examples that I want to mention. Maybe I'll erase this part. So what about the Euclidean R2? Well, we have the construction with Euclidean R2. So for small triangles, we might have that the distance between these 2 points is less than delta. They are sent on the same. But if you take large triangle, it's not possible. So there is no delta. So R2 is not delta hyperbolic for any delta. So I rather like to think that R2 is delta hyperbolic for delta equals infinity. So the geometry we are describing is not a flat geometry. It's more related to negative curvature. And Atanas asks an interesting question about, so this construction could apply to any space, even a non-symmetric metric space where there are geodesics. And he asks an interesting question about whether the Finsler metric that he introduced, the special metric that he introduced satisfies this. And to my knowledge, this is, for most of them, it is open. The second example, which is even more interesting, is the case of a tree. So a tree is a special kind of graph in which there are no cycles. So let me draw a tree. Again, I will look at my paper because drawing is not my major. So this is supposed to be V6. So this is V3, V0, V2, V7, and may put another V5, V8. So what is a tree again? It's a graph without cycles. So the paths are very easy to see, and the triangles are easy to see. So there is a triangle, so this one is V3, but I don't care. There is a triangle, which is this one. One side going from V0 to V8. Another side going from V0 to V7. And the third side from V8 to V7. And you see that this, except for the broken side, which we don't care about, so V8, V0, and V7, you see that this is a tripod. So any triangle in a tree is a tripod. So for a tree, with the metric that I defined before for graphs in general, then delta is equal to 0. In terms of curvature, for those who want to understand this in terms of curvature, a tree has a curvature which is minus infinity. Right? So we have here the two extreme cases that you have to keep in mind. And in between, there are plenty of nice objects. So as an exercise, I want you to do two things. So you look at the two-dimensional hyperbolic space. And so show that it is delta hyperbolic, and compute delta, and estimate, well, compute. This is easy to do. In the hyperbolic space, triangle has the inscribed circle, so you can do directly the construction. And the second point, the second exercise is, show that the tripod is unique for a given triangle. Of course, if the tripod were not unique, we would have difficulty to define delta hyperbolic for precise delta. Could be different from two tripods, but in fact, it is unique. And this is easy. Okay, so delta hyperbolicity is a notion which concerns big triangles. Of course, I defined it for every triangle, but if you look in a small ball, since the balls are compact, all triangles are small and thin. For example, a ball of radius delta, the distance between any two points in the triangle is less than delta. So they are all delta thin. So it doesn't say anything to small triangles. You can give the definition, it doesn't bring anything in the story. But for big triangles, then this is another story. In particular, if you go far away and you look at a big triangle, you see just a thickening of a tripod. And this is not the case for R2. So you should keep this in mind, and later we'll try to illustrate this a little bit more. All right. Good. Is that okay? I suggest to do the exercise. They are not complicated, but you get to learn something doing them. Right. Okay, so I'm sorry, I erased the tree. If you draw a graph, it's not true. It might be not true anymore if you draw a graph with cycle. They might be very big cycles, and then that gives big triangles. Now I want to talk about groups acting on x. Let me add the distance. So you should think to X as a universal cover of a Riemannian manifold on which the fundamental group acts by isometries. So this story with groups might be a bit complicated for some of you, and with Gilles we'll come slowly to the points where there are some complications and try to avoid them. Well, not to avoid, to explain. So I want to consider subgroup of the isometric group of this metric space, which we will usually call gamma. And we ask this group to act properly, or we'll say sometimes proper action. So what is a proper action? It's an action so that the number of elements in gamma which displace a point x less than some quantity r is finite. And this for every x and every r. It's not difficult to show that if it's true for one x, it's true for all of them. So I leave it to you. This is kind of obvious. And it could be strict or not strict, I don't care. Right? Right. So it's not difficult to show that this property here is equivalent to gamma being discrete in this isometric group. You can endow this isometric group with some topology, I guess compact open, something like this, compact open topology, and this property here is equivalent to the group being a discrete subset in the isometric group. So it's not a group with orbits which accumulate around a point. On the contrary, there might be fixed points, but in a given ball, if you take a point and you look at all the translate, there are finitely many. So this is a situation which looks very much like the case of a Riemannian manifold, or for those who are familiar with orbifold, it's the same story. Okay? And here comes a point which is a bit tricky. I will talk about generating set. So I will assume that gamma, so this is one assumption, but in most of our theorem, this follows from the other assumptions. Gamma is finitely generated as a group. I guess I don't need to define finitely generated. It means that there is a finite set of elements, which I call gamma 1, gamma n, so that any other element in the group is a product of the elements in the generating set. So for the sake of simplicity, we'll always take symmetric generating set, meaning that if an element is in the generating set, then the inverse we also put by brute force in the generating set. Sigma is finite. Okay. So this is exactly the counterpart for group of the assumption at the beginning of properness of the space. And I don't know if you are familiar, but associated to these data, gamma and sigma, there is a natural graph, which is called the Kelle graph. So let me describe briefly the Kelle graph, which you probably know. So this is a graph which depends, so I will graph of gamma, which depends on the group, but also on the generating set. So you do the following. You start with the identity, and then you put another vertex and an edge for all generators, for every generator. By every generator, I mean every element of the generating set, so you have to put the inverse also. And so on. And then you put an edge every time you multiply the element by some element of the generating set. So let me not write more. I can spend hours drawing graphs, but it's useless. Don't learn that much. Right? At some point, so it's just a graph a priori, because at some point it might close and you get a cycle. And the cycle corresponds to the fact that this element is written as a product of element on this side and product on the other side. So there are two different ways to write an element as a product of element in the generating set. And you can endow this graph with a distance, as I did before, one on each edge, right? So let's call it D sub G. So we get a metric spaces like this, right? And sometimes this graph is delta hyperbolic for some delta. So we say that the group that gamma is hyperbolic in the sense of Gromov if for every sigma there exists some delta such that the graph, well, G dG is delta hyperbolic. Well, in fact, there are some subtleties. This delta may depend on the generating set. For a group, there are plenty of generating sets. But if this metric space is Gromov is delta hyperbolic for some delta, if you change the generating set, it will be true for all finite generating set. And for another generating set, it will be delta prime hyperbolic. That's why I didn't write delta hyperbolic here, because this delta is not well defined. It depends on the generating set. So this is a clear and hopefully correct statement. So this notion of hyperbolicity can be transported to groups, and this is very important, because then we have a family of groups for which we can say something hopefully interesting. So the last piece of data that I need are measures, and I'll go quickly because I want to finish. Well, finish, no. So there are several notions of measures that we can consider. So I have a list here, but I will introduce them slowly during the lectures. So today I will consider only one, and it is the following one, the most stupid one. For a given x in the space, so we assume that there is a group acting correctly, as I mentioned, properly. For a given x, we can look at the orbit, and so on and so forth. And this gives rise to a measure, which is the counting measure on the orbit, which is just the sum of delta mass for every element of gamma. So this is a measure. Non-negative, non-trivial. It just, if you take the measure of a ball, for example, of a ball of radius, of a ball of radius r, then it is just counting the number of elements in gamma such that the displacement at x is less than r. So we are counting element in the groups which moves a little bit x from a distance less than a given r. And this is, for the study of groups, this is a very interesting quantity. And probably Gilles in two days will go a bit further, or me, I don't remember who is doing what. And now we kind of have more or less. So there are other measures that I wanted to talk about, but let's forget it let's forget them for today. Right? Right. So most of the time, most of the time, we will assume most of the time, if not all the 10 hours, during all the 10 hours, we'll assume that there is a compact quotient. So if we have a group acting on the metric space which acts properly, then you can make the quotient, and the quotient is Hausdorff because of the properness of the action. And so you can induce on the quotient some distance. So let me name the distance, d bar. And most of the time, we'll assume that the quotient is compact, right, with this induced topology. So correspond to the study. So this corresponds to the study of compact manifold, Riemannian manifold, where quotient on the universal cover by some group acting. Right. So we come back to the question that was asked this morning by Atanas. So what are the isometries on these very special metrics? And this is not known. And when do you have enough isometries to produce a compact quotient? And it's very rare. Well, we have no example. Well, we have one example. So for the Hilbert metric, it's known, and I've checked during the lunch, that if you have, for a convex set, if you have a subgroup of the group of isometry such that the quotient is compact, then we are in the hyperbolic case. Then the convex is some ellipsoid. Oh, well, so there are several works. There are works where people assume some regularity of the boundary. There are works where people assume a bit less. The last work that was published is from Bruno Colbois from Neuchâtel and Verovic from Chambéry. And it states, so this work assumes that the boundary is C3, and it states that if you take a subgroup of the isometry group of the corresponding Hilbert distance, then it is always finite. So there is no way you can have a compact quotient. So there are very few isometries in this situation. But we'll present plenty of situations where there are plenty of isometries. And in particular, it's not difficult to check on this graph that the group acts transitively. And so there is a compact quotient which corresponds to circles for each, a little bit more complicated, but you can describe the compact quotient of this action. Right, so I have just enough time to finish. So the key invariant that we have been working for the last, I just count before coming, 30 years. 31, I'm sorry. I hope you don't mind. Is the entropy of a metric space. So in fact, it's the entropy of a metric space endowed with some measure. So let me call it mu, and we'll switch to the one I described before. So it's a very simple object. We look at ball of radius r, and we want to see if they grow exponentially. If the volume grows exponentially, we don't have a volume, so we take this measure, compute the logarithm, divide by r, and take a limit. Sometimes there is no limit, we take the infinite. And this we call the entropy of x, d, and mu. Right. So most of the time, we'll have a compact quotient, and mu will be the counting measure that I presented. And in fact, this limit is not a limit. This limit is a limit. And here there is an x. You should ask why it does not appear here, so you can easily show that it does not depend on x. Yeah. Well, what do you need? Yes, what do you need? Well, you can write it down. But then it's useful for special metric space, which we will describe. But you just need a measure. So, well, you need this to be non-zero. So you need a measure such that the balls have a positive measure, right? Well, you need this to be non-zero for big R, not for small r, only for big R. So you need at least one ball such that the measure is positive, non-zero. And then you can define this.
And the order is two?
Excuse me?
You take limit over R?
Over R. Yeah, R goes to infinity. I'm sorry, I should have written it. Thank you. The X is here just to draw balls, but it does not depend on X. So if I had time, I would give some example of computation of this. But we started to study this example with manifolds. So let me come back to the Bishop-Gromov inequality. That was proved this morning by Soma. So the Bishop-Gromov inequality says that if we have a manifold, a complete manifold, so there is no dimension restriction. Even in dimension one, it's okay. It's stupid, but it's okay. So take a complete manifold and you assume that the Ricci curvature is bounded below by something like this, where k is a real number. Then you can compare the ball in M around a point of radius R to the ball, the volume of the ball of the comparison space, which is a constant curvature K. That's what Soma said. And so the formula, I will write it a little bit differently. So we are on a manifold, so as a measure, I take the volume. And if you take two radii and take ball, which are centered at the same point, and can imagine that small r is smaller than big R, then this is less than the same quantity that was called Vk of R this morning, the same quantity for the space whose curvature is sectional curvature is constant equal to k. Am I correct? Okay. And these numbers we know we can compute by integrals, but we don't care. Right? And so this is a sharp inequality. That's the point. This is very interesting. In fact, for those who are familiar with the Riemannian geometry, you should play the following game. Try to think to all the theorems that have been proved using this, and then you take them out of the mathematics and see what is left. So certainly you lose the proof of the Poincaré conjecture. Right? So this is a very crucial inequality. And one consequence that was mentioned, so this is so-called Bishop-Gromov. So the first inequality that was proved was from Bishop, and I don't want to mess around with the inequality, which is this one. Am I correct? Yes, I think I am correct. Yeah. So it's a comparison of volume of ball, and Gromov made one which allowed to make a comparison of ratio of volume of ball. And in fact, as Soma explained this morning, this quantity is non-increasing. And this, or maybe this one is non-decreasing, I don't remember, I reverse maybe, it doesn't matter. I don't like formulas. And so it's just a little tiny remark which is a revolution for geometry. So you could do this kind of remark. Right, but then volume of balls, if you want to compute, you can replace mu by the volume, this given inequality. Right? Is it in the... Yeah. So this gives that the entropy of M, the distance associated to the Riemannian metric, and the volume associated to the Riemannian metric is less than the growth of this volume, which is the entropy of the space of constant curvature, which we know, and which is n minus 1. Let me take k non-positive, and it's n minus 1. It should be square root of absolute value of k, or right? Square root because it behaves like the inverse of a distance. I think it is it. So we can control this quantity in the Riemannian situation just by a lower bound on the curvature, right? But as we always do in mathematics, when you have a theorem, you take the conclusion of the theorem as a definition. So now we are in a situation where there is no lower bound on curvature because there is no curvature. But this exists. So we'll take an upper bound for this entropy as a replacement for a lower bound on the curvature. And of course, it's infinitely much weaker because curvature is something you compute at every point. A lower bound is at every point, and here it's just at infinity. It's just an asymptotic quantity. Right? So for now on, every time I write an upper bound of the entropy, it will replace a lower bound of the Ricci curvature, right? For spaces for which Ricci curvature does not exist. Wonderful. I thought I would never reach this point. So now I want to state the main theorem, and I'll stop. The main theorem for the first part of the course, because there are several main theorems. So I insisted on the fact that Bishop-Gromov inequality is very important. So we try to show, to prove a version of Bishop-Gromov inequality in our context. So let me state it. Excuse me? Oh, yeah, the name entropy comes from dynamical system. And in fact, for non-positively curved Riemannian manifold, it's related to the entropy of some dynamical system on the manifold, where on the unitary bundle, which is called the geodesic flow. So the name comes from this association. It really comes from a dynamical system, where they look a dynamical system in the large one. And you want to capture the coefficient of exponential growth of some object. Well. So let me state the theorem, and I never remember the hypothesis, so I will take my notes. Are there any other questions? Any other question?
So if you can explain more about entropy,
would
be great.
If I can what?
Explain more about entropy.
Say more. Not today, because I'm done today, but maybe I'll start next time to say more, okay? Is that okay with everybody? Good, because I have to stop. I still have 2 minutes, so I want just to state the theorem. Yeah? So we'll start with a metric space, which is delta hyperbolic for some delta. So for me, this includes the space being geodesic and proper and so on and so forth. We'll take a subgroup of the isometric group acting on the space, well, isometry of XD, right? Acting properly also, and so on and so forth. And we assume that there is a compact quotient, and we look at the diameter of the quotient. We assume that the diameter is bounded above by some quantity D, and that the entropy is bound above So with this measure, is bounded above by H. Right. So this measure could be replaced by anything else, but we'll come to that in the third course or fourth course. So this is a curvature assumption, as I mentioned, which is hidden behind this. This is just that the quotient is compact, and we compute its diameter, and we look at all metric spaces such that the diameter is bounded by some fixed number. And then we have, so for every x in x, for every r less than r less than infinity, and something is missing here, but let me write it down, then the measure with our counting measure of the ball of radius capital R divided by the measure with our counting measure of the ball of radius small r is less than So I'm sorry about the numbers. We like to put numbers. We like to have explicit things. And it's not optimal. Right. So unfortunately, it's not true for all radii. And we have to bound them from below by 10 times d plus 2 delta. So the delta appears here, is this one. D is the diameter. And H, the entropy, appears here. Okay, so in other words, this is the number of element gamma such that the distance of x to gamma x is less than r, divided by the number of element gamma such that the distance from x to gamma x is less than small r, which is expressed in terms of a ratio of measures, and is bounded above by a quantity that we can explicitly. And this is the key for the compactness and the finiteness theorem. So this looks very much like a Bishop-Gromov inequality. And in fact, it plays this role in a context where we have no curvature. OK, so tomorrow I intended to give the proof of this, so I hope you don't mind.
Yes.
You mind? No, you want to see the proof. OK, good. I'd be happy. But I will start by saying a few words about the entropy, since you are interested. Yeah? And I stop here. Thank you very much.